Leah here from Leah4sci.com, and in this video, we'll continue the SN1 reaction by analyzing a couple of mechanisms. We'll start by analyzing the reaction of 1-iodo-1-methylcyclohexane reacting with an acid catalyst in a methanol solution. For all substitution and elimination reactions, you want to analyze four things that will help you determine which reaction takes place. And the four things we'll look at are the alkyl chain leaving group attacking nucleophile or base and solvent. I have a video discussing each of these topics, which you can find on my website, leah4sci.com/substitution-elimination. We'll keep this list on the side so that we can refer to it, giving us room to work through the reaction. Starting with the alkyl chain, we're specifically looking at the carbon that's holding the leaving group. In this case, we have a tertiary carbon, which can form a stable carbocation, something we want in an SN1 reaction. This means that I can have my one type, meaning an SN1 or E1 reaction. So we'll write tertiary carbocation, one type. The next thing we look at is iodine. Iodine is a very large halogen, and when it leaves and forms a negative charge in solution, we'll be able to distribute that charge over the large molecule, making it a good leaving group. This doesn't necessarily tell me between a one or two type reaction, but rather tells me that the reaction will be relatively quick compared to a reaction that has a bad leaving group or a leaving group that doesn't want to leave at all. Next, we look at the attacking nucleophile or base, but in this case, we don't appear to have one. All we have is an acid catalyst dissolved in a methanol solution. This is a case of solvolysis, which means the solution itself is going to be your attacking molecule. So let's analyze methanol as a nucleophile, given that we're only looking at the substitution reaction. Methanol dissolved in an acidic solution cannot form methoxide, which is a negative oxygen. Methanol as a nucleophile has lone pairs of electrons on an electronegative oxygen, making it a weak nucleophile, not capable of kicking out a leaving group, but it is capable of attacking any positive charge that would form in solution. And lastly, we'll look at methanol as a solvent. Since it has a hydrogen atom bound to oxygen, it's a polar protic solvent capable of stabilizing any charges that form in solution. Once again, this would stabilize an SN1 reaction. So let's begin. We have the carbocation formation step when iodine takes the electrons that bind it to carbon and breaks away in solution. This gives me a positive charge on the tertiary carbon and a negative charge on the iodide in solution. We do a quick charge analysis. We start with a neutral molecule. In the intermediate step, we have a positive and a negative that cancels out. That means our charges are all accounted for. We won't focus on the iodine anymore, keeping in mind that it will be dissolved in methanol and just off somewhere in solution. Since this is a solvolysis reaction, one of the solvent molecules will reach out and attack the carbocation with a lone pair of electrons on oxygen, forming a bond between the oxygen and the carbon. Since oxygen used the lone pair to create that bond, it only has one lone pair remaining and a formal charge of +1. To get rid of that charge, we bring another methanol molecule from solution to reach out with its oxygen atom, remove the hydrogen from our molecule, and give oxygen back its lone pair of electrons. For our final product, we have an OCH3 attached to the carbon atom that used to hold the iodine. We also have a protonated methanol, which is the regeneration of our acid catalyst. It appears that the final step has a net charge of +1, but don't forget the I- off somewhere in solution, which cancels out that positive charge, giving me a conservation of charge through every step of this reaction. One thing we did not look at here is the stereochemistry of the starting and ending molecule, and that's because our starting molecule was achiral. Now let's see what happens when a chiral molecule undergoes an SN1 reaction. Notice that on the right we have a chlorine coming forward, but don't forget the invisible hydrogen going back. Same thing with the methyl on the left. The methyl comes forward, but the invisible hydrogen goes to the back. That means our starting molecule has two chiral carbons. Before we start the reaction, let's quickly analyze the checklist to verify that indeed we can have an SN1 reaction take place. We'll start with the alkyl chain. We're specifically focusing on the carbon that's holding the chlorine atom. Since it's a secondary carbon, it will form a stable carbocation, but not as stable as a tertiary, so we can potentially have competition between a one-type or a two-type reaction, meaning SN2E2 or SN1 and E1. We'll write 1 and 2 to show that they're both possible. The leaving group chlorine forms a stable enough negative ion in solution, and so is considered a decent leaving group. Next, we analyze the attacking nucleophilar base, but once again we're dealing with a solvolysis reaction where the solvent is the nucleophile, again because we're focusing on substitution rather than elimination in this reaction. H2O is a weak nucleophile and can only undergo a one-type reaction, meaning SN1 or E1. And finally, H2O is a polar protic solvent which will happily stabilize any charges that form as intermediates of the reaction. Let's go back to the initial comment where we mentioned that you can have a competition between a 1 and 2 type reaction. Given that the leaving group is on a secondary carbon, we do have that competition. However, the presence of an acid catalyst or H+ in solution tells me that we cannot form any strong negative charges. So even though we can have a 2-type reaction with a secondary leaving group, water isn't strong enough to undergo a 2-type reaction, meaning it's not strong enough to kick out chlorine. And instead, because it's so weak, it will have to wait for chlorine to leave, wait for their positive carbocation to form, and then jump on the opportunity of that positive charge and attack because it's a weak nucleophile. And this is why you have to analyze all 4 components before you determine your reaction, because some may be ambiguous, but when analyzed together, you'll get a much clearer picture of the reaction about to happen. We got rid of the invisible hydrogens to make it easier to see, and the reaction starts out when chlorine grabs the electrons connecting it to carbon and breaks off. In addition to the Cl- forming in solution, we also have a positive charge on the carbon that used to hold the chlorine. The starting carbon was sp3 hybridized, and that is how we were able to have a chiral carbon. However, this is where you have to be careful. When the chlorine broke away, leaving a positive charge in its place, the hybridization changed from sp3 to sp2. While sp3 has a tetrahedral geometry, the sp2 carbon is going to be trigonal planar or simply flat. Given that the sp2 carbon is flat, we lost chirality, giving me an achiral intermediate. For the carbon that underwent the SN1 reaction, since carbon is now flat, for the next step of this reaction, water can attack the carbon from the top, or it can attack the carbon from the bottom, potentially giving me 2 different stereochemical products. I drew the arrows in different colors so that we can follow the progress of each one separately. We'll start with the blue arrow that shows the water molecule attacking from above. The water is now coming out of the page on the product, but it does have a lone pair and a positive charge, which means we have to bring in another water molecule to use its electrons and remove that hydrogen, giving oxygen back its electrons. As you can see, the final product has 2 chiral carbons where the OH and the chlorine appear to have the same stereochemistry. However, if we look at the second attack that happened, where the water molecule attacked from below, we show the OH2 having added with dashes rather than wedges, giving me the exact opposite chirality of our initial product. We don't have room to show the next step, but know that a water molecule comes in, grabs that hydrogen, so we'll show that being removed, and gives oxygen another lone pair of electrons. And these are the 2 products of my reaction. Notice that the methyl group has not changed its chirality because it did not take part in this reaction. However, the OH group, while chiral, is forward on one molecule and back on the other. Since we have 2 chiral groups where one stayed the same and the other changed, the 2 products are considered to be diastereomers of each other. But if we want to understand what happened in this reaction, you can say that the product underwent racemization, meaning that we have a racemic product that is 50% R and 50% S for the carbon that underwent the SN1 reaction. And this happened because the chirality is lost in the sp2 carbocation intermediate. And that means if you start chiral and end chiral but undergo an achiral intermediate, you're going to lose the specificity, meaning you're going to lose any pure R or pure S that you started with and instead wind up with a 50-50 mix. Be sure to join me in SN1 Part 3, where we analyze one final reaction that involves a hydride shift and a carbocation rearrangement. Are you struggling with organic chemistry? Are you looking for information to guide you through the course and help you succeed? If so, download my ebook, 10 Secrets to Acing Organic Chemistry, using the link below, or visit leah4sci.com/orgosecrets. That's O-R-G-O secrets. For information regarding online tutoring, visit leah4sci.com/orgotutor.
That's O-R-G-O, tutor.
If you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up and even share it with a friend or two. If you have any questions regarding this video, leave a comment below or contact me through my Facebook page at facebook.com/Leah4sci. There will be many related videos posted over the course of the semester, so go ahead and click the subscribe button to ensure that you don't miss out.